Dear children, welcome to the social class. Bless you all in the name of Lord Almighty. Children, have a disciplined life to have a successful life. Children, we are learning history unit 2 for a long days. So this class, the last class of history unit 2, successfully we are going to complete that lesson. That is this lesson what we have learnt about. We are learning about trade, from trade to territory. Who's trade to territory? The British, the English people, those who came to India for trading purpose. Now what did they do? They are capturing the territories of India and they became the administrative power in India, especially after the some wars. What are the wars between India rulers and the British? Just recall the Battle of Plassey, Battle of Buxar, series of 3 Carnatic wars, 4 Anglo-Mysore wars, 3 Anglo-Maratha wars. All these wars gave success to the British and they became the administrative power in India. Those who came to India for trading purpose, now they became conquering of territories in India. The heading of this lesson indicates that from trade to territory, how did the British achieve? Then the British administration organization in India, we learned in the previous class, there are 4 important institutions in their hands. What are they? Civil service, army, police and the judicial system. All these are very important for recruiting people. They are conducting civil service examinations and for protecting themselves. They kept a very well trained, disciplined army, and to give protection to the people and their factories, they have a good police system which was introduced by Lord Cornwallis. Lord Cornwallis, Lord Wellesley, these people are playing a very important role in developing the British Empire in India. And their judicial system is also very effective one, which make the India, British territories in India a powerful one. The British people, they kept a very good army, police force and judicial system to develop their positions in India. This class we are going to learn about 2 important policies introduced by the British in India. One is the subsidiary alliance. Alliance means making unity with the British people. That was introduced by Lord Wellesley. The main motto behind this was the annexation of Indian territories with the British. Subsidy means paying something. Suppose if you are living in a home, you have to pay a rent. Suppose if you are hiring a car, you have to pay the higher rent for that. So like that, the British people, they decide to get some subsidy from the Indian rulers for giving protection to them. Why did the Indian rulers want to get protection from the British? The Indian rulers were surprised and wondered about the British army because they used guns, tanks, everything. At that time, we have only artillery, cavalry, elephantry, like that. We didn't have so many weapons like British people. So the Indian rulers were wondered about the weapons handled by the British. So they wanted to get protection from the British people. So keeping that in mind, the British Governor General Lord Wellesley, he introduced a system which was known by the name Subsidiary Alliance, that to bring all the princely states of India under the control of the British. The main motto was that it was the most effective instrument used for the expansion of British territories and also the political influence in India. All the princely states which joined under this subsidiary alliance system were known by the name protected state. That is, the protection was given by the British. That's why they were called by the name protected state. And the British came to be referred as the paramount power. Paramount power means the supreme power in India, like that. So what was the promise given by the British to the people, to the Indian rulers, those who joined under this alliance, was they would safeguard the state from external aggression and also help the rulers to maintain the internal peace. See how they are attracting the Indian rulers. So the Indian rulers, those who are unequal in unity, those who are very ignorant, those who are not having any proper knowledge, those who are not aware of the diplomacy character of the British people, most of them joined under that. They thought that the British would give protection to them. Was the motto of the British is to give protection to the Indians? No. Their main motto was to brought the Indian states under their control. So one of the best instrument used by British to annex the Indian states under their control was the subsidiary alliance. Who introduced the subsidiary alliance? Lord Wellesley. What was the motto behind that subsidiary alliance? To bring all the princely states under the control of the British. Is this the effective one? Yes, it was the most effective instrument for the expansion by the British people. How was the princely state known as? It was known as the protected state. And how was the British came to be referred? They were referred as the Paramanpar. What are the guarantees given by the British? They guaranteed that they would safeguard the state from external aggression. Any foreign body attacked the ruler who joined under subsidiary alliance, they will help him. And also suppose the people make any revolution against the ruler, the British would help them. That is to maintain the internal peace. So they attracted the Indian rulers to join under the subsidiary. Did you think that they did everything freely? No. If any Indian ruler joined under the subsidiary alliance, they have to give some territories to the British. Their main motto is that getting some territories. Those who came for trade, now they are involving in getting territories. And also they have to pay some subsidy. That is every year per annum. They have to pay some rent to them for maintaining the army, for maintaining the British resident in India. So totally the system was benefitable to the British. Children, let us see what were the main features of the subsidiary alliance. Subsidiary alliance, which was introduced by Lord Wellesley to brought all the princely states under the control of the British people. The first feature, any Indian ruler who wanted to join under this alliance, they had to dissolve their own armed forces and they had to accept British forces in his state. That's the first thing done by the Indian ruler, those who joined into the subsidiary alliance was, what they had to dissolve? They had to dissolve their own army. And he has to accept the British forces in his state. And a British resident would stay in his capital. In the capital of the empire of the ruler, who would stay? A British resident would stay. So he had to maintain British army. To control that, a leader, British resident would stay in the capital of the particular empire. And who would pay for the maintenance charges of these all things? It should be paid by the Indian ruler. So he had to pay for the maintenance charges for army. Not only that, he had to pay annual payment or some territory should be permanently given to the English East India Company. How useful to the British it is. Have you think about that? The British, with the expansion of the Indian ruler, they were maintaining their army. And for maintenance was met by the Indian ruler. The English East India Company was getting some territories also permanently for them. So it was useful to the British people. But our foolish and the ignorant rulers, many of them joined under this. And another condition is, first condition, the king who joined under the subsidiary alliance had to dissolve his own armed force and accept the British force. Second goodness, the British resident would stay in his capital. And the maintenance charges of the army should be met by the Indian ruler. And he had to make annual payment to the company. And some territories also permanently he had to given to the company. And fourth condition is, no non-English European official should be turned out of his state. Should he stay in state? Especially the French, many French people were working in the as officials under so many Indians. So, to get rid of the French people and other non-English European officials from India, English followed this non-subsidiary alliance. All the non-English European officials should be turned out of his state. And also, suppose the native ruler, he wanted to deal with any foreign policy means, he should not deal with of his own. It should be dealt through the English people only. The British would undertake on behalf of all this. What were the conditions? They had to dissolve their army. They had to accept the British force. A British resident would stay in the capital. All the maintenance charges of the army were met by them. And annual payment should be given by them to the company. Some territory should were permanently given to the company. All non-English European officials should be turned out of his state. And native ruler should not deal with any foreign policy. He had to deal through the English. And because of all these, the British would undertake to defend the state. Defend means to protect the state from internal trouble as well as the external attack. That's the only thing done by the British people to the Indian rulers. So the lazy Indian rulers, those who are the irresponsible one, innocent one, ignorant one, those who are not interested in the welfare of the people, what did they do? They enjoyed their luxurious life and gave these all things to the British people. Some of the rulers joined under that. Let us see who were the rulers. What were the merits of the British gained through the subsidiary alliance system? All the merits were gone only to them, not to any of the Indian rulers. The first one thing, the company maintained a large army at the expense of the Indian rulers. For the company to maintain their army, who was spending the money? Indian rulers were spending the money. And all the Frenchmen in the service of the native rulers were dismissed. And the danger of French revival was completely eliminated. This is also the benefit for the British people. The British were in a dilemma of the danger comes from the French as a rival for them. The French may revived. Revived means they may woke up away from their failures. And they may revolt against the British. That was the fear of the British. But now what happened? All the Frenchmen in the service of the native rulers were dismissed. And the second thing is, the British company, they began to control the foreign policy of the princely states. Because they told the Indian rulers they should not deal with any foreign rules. Only any foreign policy should be dealt through the company. So it made the company to control the foreign policy of the princely states. And Wellesley very diplomatically made the British as the paramount power in India. Paramount power means supreme power, the highest power in India. And he transformed the British Empire in India into the British Empire of India. That's a difference between that in and off. You must understood there. It was said that first it British Empire in India. Now it becomes the British Empire of India. This indicates that most part of the India came under the control of the British people after this subsidiary alliance system. The full credit goes to Lord Wellesley, who was very successfully and diplomatically means very cunningly, very foreseeing, that is thinking about the future policies, future benefits. He planned well and executed the policy of the subsidiary alliance, and he made many of the people to join under that. That's why he brought lot of merits only to the British people. No merit was given to the Indian rulers. It made the Indian rulers very poor in their administration, very poor. We become a slave under the others. Suppose you think that in your home, some of the people are saying that we will protect your internal affairs, we will protect you from foreign, and we will stay here, all the expense will be met by you, like that somebody came and sat in your home. It won't give any effect to your father's power, and your mother's role was controlled by that people, means how it would be. The home become, the full home members become a slave under that people. Like that, the Indian rulers, those who joined under the subsidiary alliance, became a slave under these people. They become very irresponsible. They become oppressive. They are suppressed by the British rulers. So all the subsidiary alliance policy brought only merits to the British people, not any merit to the Indians. Merit means advantage to the Indians. The subsidiary alliance system brought lot of merits only to the British people. What were the defects to the princely states? Subsidiary alliance made the Indian rulers weak, oppressive and irresponsible. That is, they never worried about the people. Subjects, their subject. Their subject means their people. A king should worry about his people. That is very important. How parents are taking care of the children. Like that, any king, those who are ruling an empire, they must take care of their subjects. Then only the kingdom will be developed. And they never exploit them. Exploit means snatching money from them, raiding lot of taxes, and never worried about their income. Everything that is called as exploiting them. So that was happened there. Now, the subsidiary alliance made all the Indian rulers weak, oppressive and irresponsible, and protected by the British arms, their people neglected their duty. What was the duty of the king? They have to worry about their people, and they should help them to develop economically. But here what happened? They were exploiting the people. And let us see who were the Indian rulers who joined under the subsidiary alliance system without worrying about the welfare of the people. The first state joined under that was Hyderabad. It was joined in the year 1798. It was followed by Tanjore in the year 1799, and Awadh in the year 1801, and Peshawar in the year 1802, Bonsal in the year 1803, Gwalior in the year 1804, Indore in the year 1817, Jaipur, Udaipur and Jodhpur in the year 1818. Look at these people, this much of states joined under the subsidiary alliance without worrying about their people, worrying about their responsibilities. It shows that kings were very luxurious in their life, and they never worried about the people, and they were selfish people, and they were the very irresponsible people also. So if they were like that, would the kingdom develop? would the people be happy? No. It made the kingdom fully, completely surrender under the British people. And the British, they were also selfish. They never worried about the people. So the British also never took care of the people. The kings were also never took care of the people. So it was a great loss, and the loss to the people only. People means the people, those who are living in the particular states. So it made the kings especially irresponsible. So we should not be irresponsible in our life, children. So in the previous class I told you, learned from the British about how disciplined they were all. Discipline leads you to successful life. But at the same time, irresponsibility leads you to failure and delay in all your works. So from the childhood days, you be responsible in all your duties. Like subsidiary alliance, the one more thing was the doctrine of lapse, which was introduced by Lord Dalhousie. He was also considered as one of the chief architect of the British Empire in India. Architect means he didn't building it, but he followed the policy, doctrine of lapse. Through that policy, he annexed so many Indian states. That's why he was also known as one of the chief architect of British Empire in India. He was an imperialist. Imperialist means who was the follower of imperialism. What does imperialism mean? Do you know that? There is expansion by any means, by military forces, by giving some money, or by waging war, like that. That is called as the imperialism. So this person whose main motto was to expanding the British Empire in India. That's why Lord Dalhousie was known as the imperialist. He adopted a new policy which was known by the name Doctrine of Lapse. At that time, you may think that suppose any of the couple or any of the husband and wife cannot have a child of their own, what would they do? They may adopt a child. So that is a practice in present day life. Like the same, at that time, many of the Indian rulers, those who didn't have their own heir means own son, to follow him in the throne. At that time, it was the practice when a king died, who would be the next king? His son. Suppose if there was no own son, the king had the habit of adopting a child, male child. And when the male child became a man, he became the king. So British people, especially Lord Dalhousie, noticed that many kingdoms were there with adopted son. There were no natural heir. That is, there was no own sons there for the kings. Then he thought of a plan. The plan was resulted to doctrine of lapse. What did the doctrine of lapse mean? He said that the native rulers adopted children without the permission from the company. So, what a thing. If they want to adopt a child, they had to get the permission from the company. Huh? Then, if they adopt a child without getting permission from the company, the condition was, suppose the king died, an adopted son would get only the personal properties of the rulers. Then what about the kingdom? They told that the kingdom gone to the British. So when I was started in the 8th A class of the last year, one of the boys said that, how was that possible like that? Yes, children, we too think about that. But the British people, Lord Dalhousie, he followed the doctrine of lapse. According to the doctrine of lapse, what did he say to the Indian rulers? If they adopt a child without the prior permission from the English company, when the king died, the adopted son can get only the personal properties of the king. What about the kingdom? The kingdom would be annexed by the British. No king was ready to accept that, because at that time many states were there in India which were ruled by the adopted children. So it was bitterly opposed by the Indian people. But also the Lord Dalhousie imposed it severely and annexed so many states. So what a system introduced by Lord Dalhousie? Doctrine of lapse. What a system introduced by Lord Wellesley? That was subsidiary alliance. What was the motto behind both of the systems? Both of the systems were introduced in India to expand the British Empire and to brought the Indian states under the control of the British. Who was the imperialist in this? Lord Dalhousie was the imperialist, because he followed the policy of expansion by any means. Okay, when was the doctrine of lapse introduced in India? It was introduced in the year 1848. Let us see what were the results of this doctrine of laws. It was opposed by many Indian rulers because most of the Indian states were ruled by the adopted children, especially Jhansi. And we may hear about Rani Lakshmi Bai. Yes, one of the brave women who fought against the British. Her husband was died, so Jhansi came under the control of her. And he didn't have his own son, she adopted a son. So when British tried to annex Jhansi, she fought against the British very bravely. So this doctrine of laws motivated the Indians to revolt against the British. And in 1857, we will learn about this in the next classes. In 1857, there was a great revolt against the British. And the main root cause for that revolt was this introduction of doctrine of laws. And what were the places annexed by the British? Forcibly they are annexing them under doctrine of laws. One is Satara in the year 1848, Jaipur and Sambalpur in the year 1849, Bagkat in 1850, Udaipur in 1852. Udaipur came under subsidy alliance also. Jhansi in 1853 and Nagpur in 1854. So children, by this subsidy alliance system and doctrine of laws, so many Indian territories were brought under the control of the British people. So before concluding this lesson, we have to think about what are the factors for the success of these British? What were the specialities they had? So let us see about the factors which lead to the success for the British in all the wars. In Battle of Plassey, Battle of Buxar, 3 Carnatic Wars, 4 Anglo-Mysore Wars, 3 Anglo-Maratha Wars. And in their administration also, they got all over success. What are the reasons? Let us see about that. Children, let us see what are the factors for the success of the British in India. The first thing is their naval power. They had a supreme naval power which led to their success. And development of their textiles, that also gave them lot of money. And division of labor, scientifically they divided the labor. All this lead to their prosperity and their diplomatic planning. But on the other hand, our Indian merchants were very insecure and our Indian kings were ignorant and inequality, no unity among them. All this leads to the success of British in India. So let us recall, what are the factors for the success of British in India? Their great naval power, development of textiles, scientific division of labor, their economic prosperity and skillful diplomacy of the British. On the other hand, what about our Indian merchants and the kings? Indian merchants, they had the feeling of insecurity, no sportiness among them, no competitive spirit among them. If you don't have the feeling of insecurity in any situation of your life, children, that makes you unsuccessful in all the situations. Always have the spirit and faith on the Lord. Okay, never give up in your trials. But the Indian kings, they were unequal and ignorant. All this led to the success of the British in India. Let us conclude this lesson, children. This lesson, we have learned how did the British people, those came to India for trading purpose. Finally, they occupied so many territories in India and started their administration in India. Especially in the Battle of Plassey, which gave a success to the British and it founded the British dominion in India. That is the rule in India. The company administration was not for the interest of the people. They were only for their own selfish purpose. Especially for the development, prosperity and everything they did for the purpose of their own nation, which was their own nation, England. And they were imperialistic people and expansionist and also exploitative. That is, they are exploiting the Indian merchants, Indian kings, at that time India was one of the richest province in the world. So a lot of the things they looted from India. So it brought more territories under the British dominion, especially through the subsidy alliance and doctrine of laws. Who introduced subsidy alliance? Lord Wellesley. Who introduced doctrine of laws? Lord Dalhousie. Okay. All these things, it led to the three important rebellions against the British by the Indian people. What are the three important rebellions? South Indian Rebellion, which was happened in the year 1800 to 1801. Vellore Rebellion, which was happened in the year 1806. And the Great Revolts, which was happened in 1857. About this all, in the next class, we will learn. Children, hope that you understood the concept of this class. Go through the class clearly and try to answer the questions which are asked in the homework page. And also learn two important detailed questions. One is about the subsidy alliance and another one is about the doctrine of laws. And also children, have a disciplined life, children. Always have the courage and secured feeling. The secured feeling and courage will be given to you from the Lord if you have the faith on the Lord. So have the habit of praying with the faithful, hearted faith in the Lord. Wish you all success in your life, children. Thank you.